So with that, we'll start off. So first, development of the thyroid gland. It basically arises from the foramen cecum and then descends down into the neck. Okay. And that tract, if it remains patent or remains persistent, that becomes your thyroglossal duct, which I'm sure all of you know. So this part, which arises from the foramen cecum and then goes down, which is a part of your pharyngeal arches, pouches and stuff like that. So that is your medial analogue. Okay. That is what contains your future follicular cells. And from the fourth pouch, or they sometimes they call it as the ultimo brachial body. From there, you can get new rectodermal cells or the crest cells. They form the parafollicular or the C cells, and they are most commonly seen in the upper part of the thyroid. So basically, these are your lateral analogues. Your medial analogue and your lateral analogue will fuse in the neck. This is normally seen in the fifth week of life. Okay, fifth week of gestation. So coming to the anatomy, we know that the thyroid is a butterfly shaped gland. It is located in the anterior triangle of the neck, that is in between the two carotid arteries. It extends from C5 to T1. You have a right lobe, a left lobe, and it is connected in the middle via isthmus. Okay. Now, why is this isthmus important? We know that the gland has lymphatics. One is inside the gland, and then it can go to other lymph nodes as well. So from one lobe, the lymphatics connect to the other lobe via this isthmus. Okay, that is important, that you have to keep it in mind. Now the isthmus lies across the second to fourth tracheal ring. Here you can see this is the thyroid cartilage where my arrow is, and beneath it will be your cricoid cartilage. So your isthmus is technically just beneath the cricoid cartilage. Okay, so this is again, whatever I told is again in the slide. Now, normally the thyroid gland weighs around 20 grams, and that depends on person to person. And most important factor is the body weight. Now, it also depends on the iodine intake. When I say inversely proportional, what I'm trying to say is if a patient, his diet is iodine deficient, that means if iodine is less, he will have a goiter. So if the goiter is there, the thyroid enlarges. So the weight of the thyroid will be more. So if iodine is less, weight of the thyroid is more. If iodine is more or sufficient, then weight of the thyroid will be less. So that is what I mean by saying inversely proportional. Now coming to the relationships, the thyroid is a butterfly shaped gland which lies in front of the trachea. Okay. Anteriorly, it is related to the strap muscles. Anterolaterally, the sternocleidomastoid. Now you can see in this image, if the thyroid enlarges laterally, it goes behind the sternocleidomastoid. And I've seen quite a few when you're, no, not here, but a few UGs when I was a postgraduate to say that it extends from posterior border of sternocleidomastoid. If it is running behind the anterior border, it is, you can't actually make out till where the gland is extending. So limit yourself in your examination. So please tell from anterior border of one sternocleidomastoid to the anterior border of the other. And if you still think it is going behind, just say it is going behind the sternocleidomastoid. So we are unable to make out where the gland exactly is. So anteriorly, it is related to the strap muscles. Posteriorly, the larynx and the esophagus. And I'm sure all of you know, the thyroid gland has two capsules. Okay, the true capsule and the false capsule. The true capsule is a condensation of the gland itself. Okay, that covers the thyroid like this. And a false capsule, this is made from the deep cervical fascia. Now, we know that it has an anterior layer and a posterior layer. Okay, obviously the capsule in the front has to go attach somewhere, and the capsule in the back has to go and attach somewhere. So in this image, just don't worry about the other colors. Just look at where my arrow is going. Okay, here, these two lines. Can you see the red line here and the black purple line here? Okay. So this is your anterior layer, this is your posterior layer, and your thyroid will be somewhere here where my cursor is moving right now. So superiorly, they both fuse and they attach to the oblique line on the thyroid cartilage. Inferiorly, however, they don't fuse. Inferiorly, the anterior layer goes and attaches to the sternum, that is the posterior part of the sternum. And the posterior layer goes down into the thorax and it mixes with the adventitia of the great vessels like the arch of aorta and the pulmonary artery. So it is glaringly obvious that the inferiorly it is deficient. There is that it doesn't fuse inferiorly, that this area is vacant. So what I'm trying to say is, first of all, deep fascia is a very, very strong anatomical barrier, okay? It is not at all easy for any structure to penetrate or pierce through this and go out. So when I'm saying this, that what I'm trying to say is it's a very strong barrier. So that is the reason why you're going to have a retrosternal goiter. Normally when you have a thyroid swelling, it doesn't go up because it is fused here. It doesn't go. That's why it is only allowed to go down when it enlarges. It can't enlarge upwards. I'm sure none of you have seen a subhyoid goiter or a goiter which goes beyond the thyroid cartilage. You'll only see a goiter which goes down into the neck. Okay. Second reason is your negative intrathoracic pressure. The same way, even in a case of carcinoma, carcinoma can't easily pierce the deep fascia. Only in advanced stages or very bad carcinomas like anaplastic carcinoma, only then it can pierce this and go. Till then, it will only stretch the deep fascia, but it can't pierce the deep fascia. Keep this in mind. So coming to the blood supply, the superior thyroid artery is a branch of the external carotid artery. The inferior thyroid artery is a branch of the thyrocervical trunk. Okay. And very rarely, in up to about 5% of patients, you're going to have a thyroidema artery, which is usually arises directly from the arch of the aorta. The venous drainage, you have the superior thyroid vein, the middle thyroid, and the inferior thyroid vein. The superior and the middle thyroid vein drain into the internal jugular vein, and the inferior thyroid vein drains into the left brachiocephalic vein. So please note this diagram here, where the inferior thyroid artery is arising from the thyrocervical trunk, which is again a branch of the subclavian artery. Okay, keep this in mind. In about two slides, we'll see why exactly it is important. So coming to something which is repeatedly asked in your exams. Okay, before this, can anyone tell me why it is called recurrent laryngeal nerve in the chat box? Why is it called recurrent laryngeal nerve? Courses upwards, takes a loop and goes up. Okay, excellent. Fine, fine. Yes. Avantika got it right. Okay. So basically the origin is basically in the neck. That means it is a branch which arises from the vagus nerve. But then because of some anatomical progress, it goes all the way down and goes back up. I'm sure all of you have read about your branchial arch development in your anatomy, and all of you would have forgotten it. Please go back and read it. I'll not be stressing upon it. So there you know that the second arch artery gets vanished, or the fourth arch artery on the right side gets vanished, and there are a lot of things which goes on. So a part of it is that. Okay. So here you can see the right recurrent laryngeal nerve loops around the brachiocephalic artery, the right side, and goes and runs in the tracheoesophageal groove and then reaches the thyroid. The left recurrent laryngeal nerve loops around the arch of aorta, then runs in the tracheoesophageal groove and goes and supplies the thyroid gland. Now, most common question what they're going to ask you, even during your, either in your viva or in your entrance exam, which nerve is more likely to be damaged? It is the right recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, just look at the image and you'll get an answer. The nerve has to travel obliquely here, correct? Whereas here, it's almost a straight course for it because it has a longer distance to run. So it can aramse run in the tracheoesophageal groove. For surgeons, it has always been kind of drilled into our brain saying if it runs in the runs in the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So automatically we try searching from here to there. We are scared to go here. So because it takes an oblique course, the right recurrent laryngeal nerve is at a higher chance of damage. Apart from that, the right recurrent laryngeal nerve runs behind the artery or in between the branches, and the left runs anterior to the artery, as in it can actually be a combination of both, but more commonly this is what happens. So when it runs in between the branches of the inferior thyroid artery, sometimes, rarely, okay, without knowing, you might take the entire inferior thyroid artery branch together and ligate it. So when you do that, there is a chance that you are damaging the nerve. All right. So this is what I told you. It arises from the right crosses the right subclavian. Here it's from the aortic arch and it passes posterior or in between the artery. It has an oblique course. And what is this non-recurrent laryngeal nerve? Okay, it's a very rare anomaly, and it happens along with most commonly on the right side, very rarely on the left side. Okay, so this is what it is. So this is the normal anatomy on the right side, where you can see that the vagus, the nerve branches around the subclavian artery and comes up. Okay, sometimes because of your developmental anomaly, the subclavian artery might not form. So there is no need for the nerve to come down, because in other words, the nerve will directly arise from here. Can you see this? So the nerve is directly arising and going. This is what we call as a non-recurrent laryngeal nerve. There is no subclavian artery on the right side. It is arising from the left side and going behind and coming somewhere. So if there is no subclavian artery, there is no thyrocervical trunk, and there won't be any inferior thyroid artery. So what I'm trying to say is, during surgery, when you're doing a thyroidectomy, you can't find the inferior thyroid artery for some reason, okay, if it is not there, keep non-recurrent laryngeal nerve in mind. Don't blindly go on dissecting here and damage the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, so there's no inferior thyroid artery. Remember, think about non-recurrent laryngeal nerve. What is arteria lusoria? Please read about it. It's an anatomical abnormality which runs behind the esophagus, and eventually that causes dysphagia lusoria. Okay, it's given in the BD Chaurasia, so please go through it. So now, coming to the other nerve supply, you have the superior laryngeal nerve. It is divided into two, the internal and the external. The internal is a sensory branch and the external is a motor branch. The external laryngeal nerve supplies, like we know, the only muscle, that is a cricothyroid, and the rest of the laryngeal muscles or the vocal cord muscles are supplied by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So I don't know whether they ask you routinely this in your college, but at least when I was doing my postgraduate, this was a common question which was asked for the undergraduates. What is Sernia classification? Don't be worried. Very simple. First, draw a line to the, this is the superior pole of the thyroid. Okay. Draw a line at the superior pole of the thyroid. Draw another line which is 1 centimeter above that. Okay. So one is at the superior pole. The other is 1 centimeter above it. Okay. Now, at some point, we know that the external laryngeal nerve crosses the superior thyroid artery. If it is above this above line, that is 1 centimeter above the pole. If it is 1 centimeter above the pole, if it crosses, it is type 1. In between this, that means if it is within 1 centimeter of the superior pole, it is type 2A. And if it is below the superior pole that it crosses, it becomes type 2B. Why is this important? Because normally we ligate the pedicle here, correct? Just above the superior pole. So if the nerve is crossing at this region, there's a high chance that we might ligate the nerve as well. So the clinical importance of this classification is that in type 2A is associated with the highest amount of nerve damage during thyroidectomy. This I'll not be explaining. Please read up. It is purely theoretical and has no importance in our practical, either in thyroid carcinoma or even in practical. This is only for your viva. What is Joel's triangle? What is Bayer's triangle? What is triangle of concern? And one more, I think, what is Riddle's triangle? Please read up about it. I've just put a slide so that you guys go and read up. Okay, this is homework for you guys. So coming to lymphatic drainage, I've already told you it has extensive lymphatic networks, the thyroid gland. Okay, so it is both vascular, rich in vascularity, and rich in lymphatic supply. And we have intraglandular lymphatics. That means from one thyroid lobe, the lymphatics can travel to the other thyroid lobe through the isthmus. And from here, the first node it goes to is the central compartments. That is the level 6 group of lymph nodes. That is a pre-tracheal, pre-laryngeal lymph nodes. And the first node it goes to is called the Delphian lymph node. And from there, it goes to the lateral compartment lymph nodes. That is level 3 and level 4. Please keep it in mind. It's level 3 and level 4. Very rarely, you can have skip metastasis to the lateral compartment without the lymphatics going to the central compartment. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, normally from the thyroid, it goes to the central compartment. Okay. The one in the orange and the purple is your central compartment. And only then it goes to your anterior, that is the level 2, level 3, level 4 lymph nodes. Amongst them, most common is level 2 and level 3. Okay. So first it comes to level 6. Level 3, then to level 4. very rarely it will skip this level 6 and go directly to your other cervical lymph nodes. So this is very, very, very important in the post-surgical management of a thyroid malignancy. Okay. I know it's a repeat, but please bear with me. If you can understand and properly keep up with me for the first 20, 30 slides of thyroid anatomy and physiology, trust me, thyroid carcinoma is a piece of cake. It's literally a walkover. So from the hypothalamus, you have the thyrotropin releasing hormone, which acts on the pituitary. It has a positive effect, and that stimulates the secretion of the TSH, that is a thyroid stimulating hormone. Thyroid stimulating hormone acts on the thyroid gland. In thyroid gland, you have follicles. These follicles are stimulated by the TSH in three things. One, to increase the uptake of iodine. Second, to increase the production of thyroxine, that is T3, T4. And third, to release thyroxine. Okay, so it acts on all. One is uptake of iodine, one is production of thyroxine, and third is secretion of thyroxine. All three are stimulated by TSH. So the TSH acts on the thyroid. The thyroid will take up more iodine, it will produce more thyroxine, and it will secrete more thyroid hormones. So once these thyroid hormones are at a sufficient quantity in the blood, okay, in the peripheral tissue, it has a negative feedback. That means it goes back and it literally tells the pituitary and hypothalamus, we have enough stock, please reduce the secretion of TSH. So once TSH secretion reduces, automatically here the output of thyroxine also will eventually reduce. And that is how it maintains a constant feedback, okay, between the pituitary and the thyroid. So it's a constant mechanism where you have a positive and negative feedback. So coming to histology. This is a follicle. Okay, the follicle is surrounded by follicular cells. Inside the follicle is where you have the colloid, and the colloid contains thyroglobulin. Please bear with me, whatever I'm telling you has a very important implications in the management of a thyroid carcinoma. If you can understand this, you'll understand that. So the colloid contains thyroglobulin, which binds the thyroxine hormones. Okay, so this is another pictorial representation. This is a follicle, the basic unit of a thyroid gland, which is surrounded by the follicular cells. Inside you have the colloid, which contains thyroglobulin and the T3 and T4. Now, these follicular cells have a peculiarity that they have a sodium iodide symporter. That means it takes up iodine through this channel. Okay, so any cell which has a sodium iodide symporter takes up iodine. Okay, this becomes important in our radioisotope scan. And you can see that this is peculiar to the follicular cells, not to other cells. So the automatically, what are the other cells? Either you're going to have lymphatics in the perifollicular space. That means these are all the follicles. And in this space, either you'll have lymphoid cells, you'll have blood vessels. More importantly, you're going to have the parafollicular cells or the C cells. These don't have that sodium iodide symporter. Instead, they secrete calcitonin. Calcitonin increases the blood calcium level. Okay, that's how it acts. It decreases the blood calcium level by increasing the excretion of calcium through the urine and by inhibiting the bone resorption. Okay, so what is more important for you guys? Parafollicular cells do not have the sodium iodide symporter on them. Okay, they can't take up iodine. So now coming to symptoms and signs, what can the patient present to you with? They most commonly present you with a slow, painless mass in the neck. Okay, invariably, they're painless. When can they have pain? Only when they have hemorrhage or a sudden rapid increase in size because of necrosis. Now, what are the long-standing goiters which can cause carcinoma? A solitary nodule invariably forms a papillary carcinoma very, very commonly. And if you have a multinodular goiter, that invariably forms a follicular carcinoma in the future. That, apart from this, they can also present with swelling in the neck, which are lymph nodes. And when you come to compression symptoms like dysphagia and dyspnea, invariably they're due to compression. I've already told you, because the deep fascia is very tough and very strong. So for it to infiltrate and cause is very difficult. So invariably they are due to compression and not infiltration. So again, here you can see if it has to go to the esophagus, the tumor has to, if it is infiltrating, I'm giving you an example. If it's infiltrating, it has to pierce the deep fascia posteriorly, pierce the trachea, as in grow through the trachea, and then it has to grow into the esophagus. So for a patient to have dysphagia, if you are thinking it is because of infiltration, before that his respiration should have stopped. Okay, so the patient will never be alive for you to think about dysphagia secondary to infiltration. Okay, and few only, I've stressed on only few points. Mobility. Okay, even in the last class I saw someone said it is mobile in both superior and horizontal directions. For me, mobility has no role to play in a thyroid gland. Only two roles, only twice where mobility actually plays a role is, see, I've already told you, let's go back to the previous slide, that it moves with deglutition, correct? If it is moving with deglutation, that means it is within this false capsule and it is not infiltrated anywhere. It is within this region only. And because of that Berry's ligament, it is attached to the trachea. Now, don't tell it moves horizontally. If you have to move it horizontally, you have to move the entire laryngeal complex and it doesn't give you any information. Instead, tell me when it doesn't move with deglutation, I'll be more interested. So two conditions when it doesn't move with deglutation. One, if it is very huge that even if it's moving, you can't make out. Huge goiters. And second, if it is infiltration, that means if it is, yeah, so here, huge goiters where it is infiltrated the deep fascia and then it has gone into the strap muscle. Strap muscle don't move. No, so if strap muscles are stuck and the thyroid is stuck to the strap muscles anteriorly, the thyroid doesn't move with deglutation. Next, coming to Berry's sign. What is Berry's sign? When you can't palpate the carotid artery in a case of thyroid swelling. So two possibilities, one is displacement, one is infiltration. Now, how do you differentiate the two? So like I've already told you, this fascia, deep fascia is very strong. So the thyroid will invariably push it. So when you push the carotid artery laterally, you can no longer palpate it on the Cassoni's tubercle. That is the transverse process of the C6 vertebra. You can no longer palpate it. So you don't know whether carotid artery is infiltrated or not. Now, second scenario, if it is infiltrated, like assuming it's an anaplastic carcinoma, if it's infiltrated and gone inside the carotid artery, there is no blood supply in the carotid artery, correct? So what do we do next? Check for the next palpable artery. Above the carotid, you have the superficial temporal. So go to the superficial temporal artery and see there. If you have pulsations in the superficial temporal artery, that means it is only displaced. It has not gone through it. Whereas if you don't have pulsations there, that means it has gone through the carotid artery and it has blocked the carotid artery. Okay. And in auscultation, I know all of you will check for Bruey. Apart from that, if the thyroid is too big, position of the trachea also matters in the management. So you should also look for tracheal brash, that means auscultate in the suprasternal notch, and you will make out whether the trachea has deviated to the right or the left. If the swelling is too big and you can't make out with all your palpation method using your trail sign, T-R-A-I-L, trail sign and all, even in auscultation, you're supposed to look auscultate for position of the trachea. Okay, so investigations. So first we need to confirm the diagnosis. Okay, one thing I would like to mention at this point, I have not gone into evaluation of a solitary nodule of the thyroid. Okay, that is a separate topic. We'll cover it separately because it will dilute the topic what I'm trying to convey to you guys. So first, you're going to confirm the diagnosis. Next, you're going to stage the disease. And third, for treatment. So in confirming, we've always told you imaging before FNAC. So first you do imaging in the form of an ultrasound. Or for neck, you can do a neck X-ray to look for calcification. Or CT scan of the neck, where the only indication is for CT scan in the neck is if it is large, or if the thyroid is fixed, or if it is retrosternal. And then do an FNAC and not a biopsy. Can anyone tell me why FNAC and not biopsy? And I've stressed this in breast cancer, it is only biopsy and not FNAC. Why only FNAC? Oh wait, I've already given the answer in my slide, I'm so sorry. Yeah, correct. it can cause hemorrhage. Okay, it can cause hemorrhage. That's why we don't do a biopsy and we only do an FNAC. Okay, because I've already told you thyroid is a very vascular gland. Then you do a thyroid function test and you check for serum calcitonin, carcinoma embryonic antigen. When we are dealing with the individual malignancies, I'll tell you why this is important. Then you stage the disease. Now you know that the thyroid carcinoma is there. You need to know where all this cancer has spread. First test to be done is a radioisotope scan. Okay. If radioisotope scan can't be done for certain reasons, then you do a CT of the abdomen and pelvis, and only then you do a PET CT. So PET CT only indication is medullary carcinoma. So unless you have you're discussing a case of medullary carcinoma, please don't blurt out PET CT. This is for UGs. For postgraduates, I'll discuss later. All right. And for treatment purpose, you're going to get a complete blood count, because when you're going to operate, you need to make sure the patient is not anemic and stuff like that. You're going to do a complete blood count, a blood sugar, RFT, and you need to do your indirect laryngoscopy or a flexible laryngoscopy. It has no bearing on the disease. Instead, it has a bearing on your treatment. That means quite a good number of patients can have a paralyzed vocal cord without any hoarseness of voice. So then post-operatively, they'll tell, because you did surgery, the vocal cord got paralyzed. So for purely medico-legal purpose, we're going to get a laryngoscopy done. Yeah. So why do we need to get a USG done? So clinically, let's just assume, okay? Clinically, we have a solitary nodule thyroid. Okay, patient has come, you're palpated. Now, first and foremost, size of the nodule is important in the management of carcinoma of the thyroid. So first and foremost, you need to know the size of the nodule. Next, is the nodule cystic or is it solid? If it is cystic, less chance of cancer. If it is solid, more chance of cancer. So you need to know that. Next, look for other features. So now we are only about the nodule. So now look at the around the nodule. What is the echo texture? What is the shape of the nodule? Whether it is irregular, whether there is any calcification, look for vascularity and multicentricity. When I say multicentricity, clinically you can find only one nodule, but on ultrasound you might find other nodules or other suspicious lesions in other lobe of the thyroid or in the same lobe of the thyroid. So that is what I mean by multicentricity. Now, vascularity can be high in two places, either in hyperthyroidism or in cancer. How do we differentiate? I'll give you a clue here, or I'll tell you the answer. Invariably, thyroid cancers are euthyroid. Okay, their TFT will be normal. So in ultrasound, if you have a lot of vascularity to a nodule and thyroid function test is high, then the patient is a case of hyperthyroidism, like Graves or toxic multinodular goiter or a toxic adenoma. Whereas on ultrasound, there is raised vascularity. The nodule is very vascular, but thyroid function test is normal, or the patient is hypothyroid, keep a diagnosis of cancer in mind. Now, ultrasound, apart from telling you about the nodule, it will also help you assess the lymph nodes in the neck. Clinically, you might not be able to palpate the lymph nodes, but in ultrasound, you can pick up small lymph nodes which are actually present. And then for assisting FNAC. Now, what are the indications for ultrasound guided FNAC? Three indications: too small, too big, or heteroechogenous. I'll tell you what it is. If it is too small a nodule, instead of taking from the nodule, you'll be taking from the adjacent region, and the FNAC report will come as normal follicular cells. Second point, if it is too large, we have already told you, the central area can be necrosed. And when you take an FNAC, in necrosed, you're only going to get lymphatic cells. That's what necrosis is, right? Dead cells with some pus and all inside. You'll get only lymphatic cells. And you'll not get a diagnosis. You'll not get what you want from it. So you're going to use ultrasound guidance. Under ultrasound guidance, you can tell where exactly you want to take the FNAC from. Even from a small nodule, you can go exactly to the nodule and take it out. And from a large nodule, you can go exactly to, not to the center, but from the periphery, or where exactly you want the sample from. Next, the third one I said, heteroechogenous. Sometimes, when I say heteroechogenous, it can have both solid and cystic components in the same nodule. That time, if you take FNAC from the cystic component, you're only going to get fluid. You might not get any cells. So instead, take it from the solid component or the solid part of the swelling or from the nodule, and you will get a better diagnosis. So three indications: too small a nodule, too big a nodule, and heteroechogenous nodule. So what are the findings suggestive of malignancy in an ultrasound? Presence of microcalcification, irregular margins, hypervascularity, spotty internodular flow. And when it comes to echogenicity, benign is hyperechoic, malignant is hypoechoic. That means it is functional. That means these follicles are normal. They are functioning. That is why it is hyperechoic. Whereas in a malignant lesion, the lesion is not functional. That is why it is hypoechoic. So this is just a few images where it is hypervascular. You have calcifications here. Can you see all these tiny small calcifications? And it is hypoechoic in both these lesions. So now, what is the principle of a radioisotope scan? Okay, can anyone tell me what the atomic number of iodine is? I know all of you will very easily. Excellent. 131. 131. 127. 131. Okay. Fine. Enough. Okay. I'll close the chat box again. First and foremost, our atomic number is 53, not 131. 131 is an unstable isotope of the iodine. So what you're going to do is, you're going to, for that regular iodine atom, you're going to put a lot of energy via some radiation and you're going to increase its atomic number to 131, which is an unstable atom. So this iodine 131 will release certain, because it is unstable, it wants to become stable. So from 131 to come back to 153, or even for a matter of fact, from 123 to come back to 53, it will give out certain radiations. That energy is giving out in the form of radiations. That radiation can either be alpha, beta, or gamma radiation. Okay, so just remember, from 53 you have made it unstable by making it either 123 or 131, and the iodine is trying to come back to its stable state. By coming back to its stable state, it gives out radiation, and this radiation can damage the surrounding cells. When I say surrounding cells, in a very close proximity. So if I give radioactive iodine to the thyroid, I can't cause damage to the brain, to the kidney, to the bladder and all. Okay, it will only cause damage to the surrounding tissue. Keep this in mind. That is why I've drawn here. See, this is the ground state, the first circle. So when you give some energy, it would have gone up here. Okay, this is the excited state. Assume this is your iodine 131. So when it comes back to or becomes iodine 53, it gives out these radiations. Okay, so this is the concept. Please keep this in mind. So when it gives out these radiations, these radiations cause damage to the surrounding cells. Now, why do we use iodine? Like I told you, these follicular cells have this sodium iodide symporter. So they very easily take up iodine. Okay, you stimulate them with TSH, they take up iodine. I told you, TSH can cause three things. Uptake of iodine, increased synthesis of thyroxin, and increased secretion of thyroxin. So when TSH is raised, or when there is TSH stimulation, it stimulates the follicles to take up iodine through the sodium iodide symporter. Now your next question. What are the other tissues which take up iodine? Can be the skeletal bones, can be salivary glands, etc. But keep this in mind. Jungle mein ek hi sher hota hai. So as long as the thyroid is functional, everybody else will be suppressed. Because this is very selfish. Okay, the minute TSH acts, it takes up all the iodine. Lots and lots of iodine, and it doesn't allow any other gland to take up the iodine. That is the speciality of a thyroid gland. Okay, if you understand this, you'll understand radioiodine therapy. I hope you guys understood. I got two repeats, so I'll anyway tell you again. Atomic number of iodine is 53. To that 53, you're going to give some energy and make it 131, which is an unstable state. From 131, the iodine wants to come back to 53. Okay, it is only temporary. So when it comes back to that 53, it lets go of some energy. Because it has taken up energy, it gives out energy in the form of gamma radiation or alpha or beta radiation. This radiation can cause damage only to adjacent structures. It can't cause, it is not like your X-ray and X-ray or mammogram where it gives radiation to all around surrounding structures. It gives out only to one or two cells around and causes damage only to those one or two cells. Those radiations which are given out. Now, iodine is taken up only by the follicular cells on stimulation by TSH. So if TSH stimulates, iodine is taken up by the follicular cells. Okay. Then we'll discuss about it later. Whereas your parafollicular cells and your lymphatic cells don't take up iodine. Now, the next point is, as long as the thyroid is functional, the other glands will not take up iodine, such as the salivary glands or the bones. Even though iodine content is found there, the quantity is very, very, very minimal. And whatever iodine is given, majority is taken up by the thyroid gland. That is why in iodine deficiency, you're only going to get goiter and not some bone deficiency. Okay. So just keep that. That is the concept. Now coming to radioisotope scan. So what are the radioisotopes you can use? One is technetium, one is iodine-123 and iodine-131. Technetium-99 is a subtype of iodine, or it's an iodine analog. Okay, something similar to iodine, but not the same, but it is equally effective. Why we use this? It is cheaper and the half-life is less when compared to these two. That means whatever damage happens will happen within just 1 or 2 days, within 6 hours, but not for a very long time. That is why you use technetium over, you choose or you prefer it over iodine-123 or 131 for a scan. That is for diagnosis, not for ablation. Please keep this in mind. Not for ablation, it's only for scan. Now, what are the indications of a radioisotope scan? First and foremost, hyperthyroidism. I'll tell you why. Very simple. Hyperthyroidism can be because of two things, correct? One, either because of a single nodule, which is become hyperactive, or the internodular tissue, like in multinodular goiter, that becomes hyperactive. So for diagnosing a toxic nodular goiter, toxic multinodular goiter versus a toxic adenoma. Okay. So to differentiate those two, because the management varies, you require a radioisotope scan. So when you give this, if it is a toxic nodule, only the nodule will take up the radioisotope. The surrounding tissue will not take it up. Whereas in a toxic nodular goiter, the nodule will not take up this iodine. Only the surrounding tissues will take up. Whichever is active will take up the iodine. Next, in a case of suspected thyroid cancer, which has spread, like I've told you, if it is spread the thyroid cancer to elsewhere, once you give iodine, even for example, if it is spread to the lymph node, even the lymph nodes take up iodine then. Normally they don't take up, but if they're affected by the thyroid cancer, they take up iodine. Okay. Like I said, suspected metastasis. Then to determine congenital thyroid defects like lingual thyroid or thyroglossal duct, even they take up iodine because they still have follicles in them. Any cell which has a sodium iodide symporter, okay, which is a follicular cell, will take up the iodine. Next, to determine the efficacy of a radioactive iodine therapy, I'll give you a very simple way to understand this. We'll go directly to the end of the topic. We have operated, something has happened. And not operated, okay, we'll think about a toxic adenoma. Okay, toxic adenoma, let's assume the size is 2 into 2 centimeters, and the amount of radioactive iodine we need to give is around 40 millicurie. Okay, just keep this in mind. Now somehow your calculation goes wrong and you have given only 20 millicurie. Okay, is it sufficient? It is not sufficient, but you don't know. You have just given the radioactive iodine and you are comfortably sitting thinking that you have treated the patient. Next, so to confirm whether you have done a good job or not, you need to do a repeat scan. Okay, you're going to repeat the scan after 1 week and see whether the tissue is still hyperactive or not. If it is not hyperactive, that means whatever radioactive iodine ablation you have given has done its job. If it is still hyperactive or there is still some activity, that means the dosage what you have given in the first place was insufficient. Got it? So that is what I mean when I say radioactive iodine therapy. So if someone asks you what are the indications, these four you have to tell: hyperthyroidism, metastasis, congenital disorders, and to see the efficacy of your therapy. Apart from that, these are the other ones. For theoretical purpose, I have written it here. It will be given to you in your, the slides will be given to you and you can go through them there. Now CT neck, I've already told you, ultrasound is more than enough. Only 3 indications for CT scan of the neck: large goiter, fixed goiter, retrosternal goiter. Because in ultrasound, you can't look at the posterior surface of the sternum and all. That is why you're going to use radioisotope scan, I've already told you. And PET CT, as we discussed for undergraduates, only for medullary carcinoma of the thyroid. for postgraduates, very rarely you can have differentiated thyroid carcinomas, where post surgery it can recur, and when it recurs, it might not take up your iodine. So even if you do an isotope scan, you might not get the answer what you're looking for. So in such cases, you're forced to do a PET CT, because cancerous cells are hyperactive and they take up this fluorodeoxyglucose very well, and it is shown up on the scan. This is only for postgraduates. Undergraduates, this is over your head. Don't worry. So FNAC, it is extremely sensitive and cost effective, very cheap. What is the disadvantage? All of us know follicular adenoma and carcinoma can't be differentiated in a case of by FNAC, because FNAC only takes one or two cells. It is not a biopsy. Okay. So please keep this in mind. It is a very, very important point, and I will ask you a question in the future and this will be the answer to it. Okay. So please keep this in mind. So FNAC can't differentiate between follicular carcinoma and follicular adenoma. So laboratory studies, when you do a thyroid function test, I've already told you, invariably the carcinomas will be euthyroid. Very rarely they'll be hyperthyroid. Okay. Now all of you might wonder, why are carcinomas euthyroid? Very simple. I'll ask you guys a question which I know most of you will know the answer to. In a case of lymphoma, the patient has so many lymphocytes. No, he has close to 1 lakh lymphocytes. Does that mean his immunity is that good, or does that mean his immunity is deficient? Yeah, his immunity is deficient. The rest of you, I'll answer you guys again, PET CT and all in the last one I'm doing. Correct. His immunity is deficient because even though he has 1 lakh lymphocytes, those lymphocytes are not doing their job. They're not functional. Okay, they're not functional. That's the reason the patient is immunosuppressive. So the same way here in thyroid, even though they have lots of follicular cells, like for example, follicular carcinoma, they're not doing their job of properly producing the thyroxine. They'll take up iodine, they'll act the same, but the thyroxine, what they produce or what they do is not functional. Okay. So that is why here they're euthyroid and not hyperthyroid, even though they have lots of follicular cells and stuff like that. So others are, just give me 1 second. Yeah, I'm back. I hope you guys can hear me. Anyone in the chat section, can you guys? Audible. Yes. Okay. Excellent. Fine. We'll go ahead. Fine. So where was I? We just discussed about this euthyroid status of the thyroid. I hope all of you understood. It's pretty straightforward. Now, what are the other blood investigations you're going to get? You're going to get serum calcitonin. And we already, all of us, even before I go to medullary carcinoma, I'm sure you all, guys already know that there is something called Menn syndrome, that is multiple endocrine neoplasia. So in that, apart from thyroid, you can have tumors which are related to the adrenal as well, such as pheochromocytoma. So you might have to measure BMA, catecholamines and metanephrines in the urine. Okay. So this is also a part of your laboratory studies. I'll stress upon this again when we go to medullary carcinoma. I'm just giving a rough outline. Okay. So coming to the epidemiology, I've copied this slide from somewhere. I know it doesn't matter to us whether it is fastest growing in United States or something. But you have to remember that it is one of the most common endocrine malignancies, and more in case of women, obviously, because goiter and this and goiter is more, or thyroid swellings are more common in women. So obviously cancer is also more common in women. So this is the classification of thyroid carcinoma. It looks complicated. Please follow me. It is very, very easy. Okay. Very easy. If you have understood the anatomy, whatever I tried to teach you before, first and foremost, when I say neoplasm, it does not mean cancer. It can either be an adenoma or a carcinoma. I hope all of you have read this in your pathology. So a thyroid neoplasm is divided into benign or malignant. Okay. Now we are more concerned about malignant. We'll go ahead with malignant. In malignant, it can either be primary or secondary. When I say primary, it means that the cancer has arisen from the thyroid and then it has gone somewhere else. Secondary means it is arisen from somewhere else and then gone to the thyroid. Like for example, in breast cancer, we know that you have secondaries to the lung, the secondaries to the bone, secondaries to the liver. So the same way, breast carcinoma can also have secondaries to the thyroid. So that is what I mean by here. From kidney, that is renal cell carcinoma, it can spread to the thyroid. From breast carcinoma, it can spread to the thyroid. Similarly, soft tissue sarcoma, melanoma, and colon cancer can also spread to the thyroid. So these are secondary malignancies. That means something which arises elsewhere, and then the cancer is spread to the thyroid for some reason. Now, primary malignancy. So coming to the primary malignancy, we know that histologically there are three cells, correct? One is your follicular cells, one is your parafollicular cells, and you have the lymphoid cells. Simple. Now again, in follicular cell, they can either be well differentiated or undifferentiated. Why I'm telling you this is, well differentiated means even though it's a cancer, it retains the architecture of the cell. That means it will still continue to function. That means it will take up iodine, it will produce the iodine, what it is produced, the thyroxine what it produces might not be functional, but it will still keep doing some job. Okay. Whereas undifferentiated means it, you don't have any control over it. It will change to whatever it wants. It can spread anywhere it wants. It will infiltrate whatever it wants. So it's a very bad disease, undifferentiated. I'm sure all of you would have read this in pathology. What is well differentiated? What is undifferentiated? So under well differentiated, we have papillary and follicular. Under undifferentiated, you have anaplastic. And from the parafollicular or the C cells, whatever cancer arises, that is called as medullary cancer. And whatever arises from the lymphoid cells is what you're going to get, lymphoma. So I'll repeat, very simple. You have benign, you have malignant. And again, here you can have primary and secondary. Secondary is cancer which is arising elsewhere, which is coming to the thyroid. And primary, you're going to have follicular, parafollicular, and the lymphoid cells. These are the three cells which are found in the thyroid. From follicular, if it is well differentiated, you're going to get papillary carcinoma or follicular carcinoma. If it is undifferentiated, you're going to get anaplastic carcinoma. And if it's arising from the parafollicular cells, it is called as medullary carcinoma. And if it is arising from the lymphoid cells, it is called as lymphoma. Okay, very simple. You'll get it, don't worry. Now, what are the causes or the etiology? One is radiation exposure. I know all of you will be very excited to say X-ray, mammogram, CT. I keep repeating this every time. No. And someone kept on asking me, what is this mantle radiation for lymphoma? This is the region which is covered when you're giving the radiation. As in, when you're covered means these are the regions which get radiotherapy. So either for breast cancer or for thyroid, mantle cell radiation for Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is one of the etiological factors. Apart from that, they found that this Chernobyl nuclear tragedy which occurred, the babies which were born post that or children during that age, when this tragedy occurred, eventually developed thyroid carcinoma. Go Google about this. It's a very interesting story. You'll read about it. And for theoretical purpose, in the olden days, they used to give radiotherapy for acne, tonsils, adenoids, tuberculosis, etc. Please mention this only as a last resort. If they keep on prodding you, tell, only then open your mouth. Otherwise, don't talk about these. Hereditary, you remember just two or three genes, P10 gene, BRAF gene, and RET proto-oncogene in case of medullary carcinoma. And Hashimoto's thyroiditis eventually predisposes to Hodgkin's lymphoma. And in dietary influence, very simple. If it is iodine deficiency, you're going to get multinodular goiter. I've already told you. If it is multinodular goiter, patient can develop follicular thyroid carcinoma in the future. That's what it means. So these are the familial syndromes. I'll not go into all of them. This is just theoretical for you guys to mug up. So just remember that thyroid carcinoma can be familial, associated with all these genes. And what are the different carcinomas that can come along with it? I'll not go into this. This is for you guys to learn. All right. So now finally, we have reached the carcinomas. Trust me, if you're stuck with me or if you've understood everything I've tried to tell you so far, or even majority of it, if you've understood, then rest of it will be a breeze. Okay. You'll understand everything very simple. Papillary carcinoma of the thyroid. So this is a part of the cancer which arises from the follicular cells, and it is a well-differentiated carcinoma. Okay, most common carcinoma, that is 80% of all thyroid malignancies, more female preponderance, more common in the 30 to 40 age group. Okay, now it can either be classified under Wollner's classification into occult, intrathyroidal, and extrathyroidal. What do I mean by when I say occult? Occult means something you can't see. Okay, it is just picked up by chance. Now, patient has come with you for something, either a lymph node swelling, or he's come for some reason, okay, and you do a thyroid or a scan of the neck, and suddenly in the neck you pick up a small nodule like 1 centimeter or 1.5 centimeter, which is not clinically palpable, but this is a small nodule. Then you go ahead and investigate, and it turns out to be a papillary carcinoma. That is what I say when I mean occult primary. That means something which is not seen, which is asymptomatic, which is not picked up on ultrasound which is not picked up on clinical examination, but instead is picked up for some other reason. Okay, you have done a scan for some other reason, or you have done a CT scan for some parotid swelling, for some reason you have done, and you pick up a tumor in the thyroid. Then you call it as occult primary. If you can only normally feel the gland or the thyroid or the nodule in the thyroid, it is called intrathyroidal. If it is already spread to the lymphatics, and apart from the nodule, you are also having lymph nodes in the neck, then it becomes extrathyroidal. Okay, occult primary means picked up by chance. Intrathyroidal is when the tumor, or when you clinically palpate the nodule and it is restricted to the thyroid gland. And from the thyroid gland, if it is spread elsewhere, it is called as extrathyroidal. So clinical presentation, what we've already discussed, most common is a solitary nodule. So it can present as only a thyroid lump with the lymph node, or only lymph node. Okay. So this is exactly what we just discussed. If it's only a solitary nodule, that means it is intrathyroidal. Solitary nodule with lymph node, extrathyroidal. Only lymph node palpable and there is nothing in the gland, then it becomes a lateral aberrant thyroid. Okay, this is what we call as a lateral aberrant thyroid. Patient has come with the lymph node, you've done an FNAC of the lymph node, it shows follicular cells. That means it is a papillary carcinoma which is spread there. Okay, please keep it in mind. I know most of you will ask, will this fall under occult primary? No, it does not. This still falls under extrathyroidal. That means from the thyroid, it has gone to the lymph node. So it still falls under extrathyroidal. So these patients are euthyroid, and we have already discussed dysphagia, dyspnea, and dysphonia are in locally advanced diseases. When I say locally advanced, it is increasing in size and invariably due to compression. Now, are these swellings cystic or are they hard? This is what we call as a thyroid paradox. Cellular tumors are soft and cystic tumors are hard. I know most of you get confused. Keep this in mind. Okay, let's assume a regular Bisleri water bottle, with a soft plastic bottle, what you get. Fill it up with 1/2 liter water, rest half the bottle is empty. You can nicely squish it, correct? Because it is empty, you can nicely squish it. Now, again, completely take a new Bisleri bottle, fill it up completely with water and close the cap. Now try squishing it, you can't do it. So that is what I mean when I say tensely cystic. If it is completely filled with fluid, it becomes so tense that even if you try to squeeze, you can't. So you will not appreciate the cystic feeling at all. So that will come back as a hard swelling. Now, why are cellular tumors soft? We know that both the thyroid and the pancreas are fleshy organs. So when they're fleshy, they're just like muscle and all. When you palpate, you'll feel like they're soft. So that is what we call as a thyroid paradox. Now, lymphatics, please remember this. It spreads mainly through lymphatic system. Okay, if the thyroid papillary cancer has to spread, it is through lymphatics. Just keep this in mind. Multicentricity, when I mean, like I told you, from one lobe, it can go to the other lobe through the isthmus. So when you have a papillary carcinoma in one lobe, keep it in mind, you can have focus of cancer even in the opposite lobe because of intrathyroidal metastasis. They call it intrathyroidal mets. Doesn't mean it is M1. Okay, doesn't mean it is M1. Please keep it in mind. That is called multicentricity or multifocality. I know in breast it is different, but in thyroid you can use both of them interchangeably. Now, lymph node metastasis are common. Distant metastasis to the lungs, the bone, the liver, and the brain in only 20% of the cases of the advanced cases. And this is because of hematogenesis. But for undergraduates, just keep lymphatic system in mind. It spreads through lymphatics. Simple. So gross features, hard, white, solitary, or most commonly solitary, rarely multinodular. You can have calcification, necrosis, cystic changes. We've already discussed all this when we were talking about ultrasound. In microscopy, that is how we differentiate. In microscopy, if you get papillary projections, it is papillary carcinoma. Other causes, sarcoma bodies. Apart from that, you can have orphan anii nucleus, basically this has very less nuclear material in it, so it looks like a empty nucleus, or sorry, empty cell. That is why it is called as orphan eye appearance. And multicentricity, I've told you, even though clinically you can find only one nodule, if you've done a total thyroidectomy and send it to the pathologist, he'll tell you that in 85% of the chance it is multicentric. That means it has gone to the opposite lobe as well. And when it is multicentric, there is a high chance of lymph node involvement. That means if it has already gone to the opposite lobe, there is a good chance that it can have spread to the lymph nodes in the central compartment and the lateral compartment as well. So this is just an image. Here you can see these cancerous cells. You can see the inside is empty. This is what you call as an orphan Annie. This is the cartoon. This is that she was called orphan Annie. This is her eye. You can see there is no pupil, iris and all. So you can here also you can see there is no obvious nucleus and all. So it looks like an empty cell. That is why it's called orphan Annie eye nuclei appearance. Now, what are the variants of papillary? Only for theoretical purpose, you have follicular variant, you have a tall cell variant, you have an insular variant, diffuse sclerosing, clear cell trabecular. Don't worry about all these. These are only for pathology. It does not make a difference to your management. Just keep it in mind. If it is tall cell, it is a more aggressive pattern. So diagnosis, ultrasound of the neck. First, you're going to look at the nodule. Like I've told you, if it is one nodule, also look at the opposite lobe. Then look for the lymph nodes in the neck. And what are you looking for? You're basically looking for features suggestive of malignancy like calcification, nodularity, and hypoechogenicity. Then do an FNAC and do a radioisotope scan. If a radioisotope scan, I've already told you, because they're not functional. If it is a functional gland, they'll take up the iodine. These, they're not, the nodule is not functional. So invariably they don't take up iodine and you're going to get a cold nodule. And you can do a plain X-ray to look for fine calcifications. So diagnosis, if it is a pre-op diagnosis, that means even if it's a small nodule, you do a pre-op diagnosis, it comes as papillary carcinoma, do a total thyroidectomy irrespective of the size. Okay, please concentrate. This is where lots of confusion arises. If a pre-op diagnosis of papillary carcinoma is there, directly do a total thyroidectomy irrespective of the size. I'll tell you why later on. Now, I know all of you will say this subtotal, near total, Hartley-Dunhill procedure, all this etc. are mentioned in textbooks, even in Bailey and Love, but please keep it in mind. These are all age-old techniques where in olden days, when they were doing thyroid surgeries, they were so bothered about the recurrent laryngeal nerve and parathyroid. Okay. They always thought they were going to damage it. So they used to leave back little tissue there. Now that also they'll say tip of the finger, pulp of the finger, small finger, thumb, 4 grams, 8 grams. I am not going to go into that because clinically it is irrelevant. For VIVA purpose, please read about it. I think it is given in SRB. I don't even remember all those values like 4 grams, 8 grams and all. All this is theoretical. Don't answer any of these. Only answer total thyroidectomy. Simple. Even for multinodular goiter, the answer is total thyroidectomy. Now I know most of you will ask, sir, if it is multinodular goiter, it is a benign disease. If we leave little thyroid back, the patient can have thyroxine, which is being produced from the little thyroid gland. Please keep it in mind. Okay, this is not given in your textbooks. Even after doing a hemithyroidectomy, in 50% of the patients who have half a thyroid gland left, they can still become hypothyroid. So what can your little tissue which you leave near the recurrent laryngeal nerve and parathyroid do? Eventually, the patient is going to become hypothyroid, correct? So there is no point leaving that tissue now, because now surgeons are much more confident. They know where to look for the recurrent laryngeal nerve. They know where to look for the parathyroid. So the preferred methodology or the preferred treatment right now is a total thyroidectomy and nothing else. Nothing else. Okay. Now, before we go into other scenarios, there are certain high risk factors. If it is a male, it comes into high risk. More than 45 years, multicentricity, capsular and vascular invasion. Please remember about this. Extra thyroidal extension, distant metastasis, positive family history of cancer, history of radiation exposure, or if the cancer is high grade or poorly differentiated. All these come under high risk factors. Okay, just keep this in mind. Now comes the, I know few textbooks have said there is a role for hemithyroidectomy. So only for theoretical purpose I've used it. For papillary cancer, it is 1 centimeter. For follicular cancer, it is 4 centimeter. Can anyone tell me why it is 1 centimeter for papillary and 4 centimeter for follicular? Does anyone know? Because all of you will keep mugging this up. 1 centimeter for papillary, 4 centimeter for follicular. Okay, so I'll only give the answer. I haven't got correct. Somebody said multicentricity, extensive lymphatics. Madan KJ, excellent. That is the correct answer. Correct. Multicentricity is the correct answer. Okay. So when you have, that's why I put this diagram of this thyroid also here. When you have extensive lymphatics within the thyroid gland, even before the tumor is more than 1.5 or 2 centimeters, it would have already spread to the opposite side. You don't have to wait for the tumor to become 4 centimeters like follicular. Follicular doesn't spread through lymphatics. It more or less spreads through hematogenous route. So even before it is 1.5 or 2 centimeters, it has gone to the opposite gland. So there's no point doing a hemithyroidectomy after it is more than 1 centimeter. Okay. So less than 1 centimeter, you again classify them into this. One sec, my slides are stuck. Yeah. So let us assume that your pre-op diagnosis, you have got follicular. Some people are very nitpicky and they say it is, the size is less than 1 centimeter. If none of these features are there, only then do a hemithyroidectomy. Okay. If any one of these features are there, go ahead and do a total thyroidectomy. That means if high risk features are there, and even though it is less than 1 centimeter, do a total thyroidectomy. If it is more than 1 centimeter, directly it is total thyroid. Now, one more question. Few textbooks have mentioned lobectomy. Lobectomy is only this much you take out. Hemithyroidectomy is apart from the lobe, you take out the isthmus as well. Now, again, chat section, please become active. Why is this? Why do we not do a lobectomy? Why do we do a hemithyroidectomy? I've already given you the answer once. Yes, excellent answer. So that means you're understanding what I'm trying to tell you. These lymphatics, when they're spreading, they pass through the isthmus. Okay, that is a theoretical reason. Theoretical. Okay, now let us think about the practical approach. Assume we're doing lobectomy. Okay, just assume. Can anyone tell me where the lobe ends and where the isthmus ends? Okay, again, chat section. Is there any demarcation where the lobe ends and where the isthmus ends? Correct, no? So when you're doing a lobectomy, there's a chance you might leave back a little bit of this lobe as well. And if you're doing for cancer, why do you want to leave back little of the lobe? Instead, be on the safer side, take out the isthmus as well. So practically, this is the problem. Practically, you don't know where the lobe ends, where the isthmus ends. But for theoretically, someone asks you the answer, extensive intra thyroidal lymphatics, which passes through the isthmus. That's why we take out the isthmus, even though the isthmus is not involved. Now, let us come to the other scenarios. Assume you have done a hemithyroidectomy for a solitary nodule of the thyroid. Okay, not solitary nodule. Let us start from beginning. Patient comes with a nodule. Ultrasound is showing all features of malignancy, calcification, irregular margin, hypoechogenicity. However, FNAC, in spite of doing it with ultrasound guidance, in spite of doing all this, FNAC is telling no, it is only a regular goiter, a solitary nodule goiter. What do you do next? Okay. Ultrasound is telling it is cancer, but FNAC is telling it is not cancer. Unless FNAC tells cancer, we can't go ahead and do a radical surgery. So what we do? You're going to do a hemithyroidectomy. Do a hemithyroidectomy, send it to the pathologist. Immediately, he'll take a section, frozen section, and he'll tell you. If he says, yes, it is cancer, immediately finish off the surgery. Do off the total thyroidectomy in the same sitting. Whereas if the pathologist tells, no, it is not cancer, you can stop the surgery. Okay, you can just do a hemithyroidectomy and get out, because end of the day, pathologist has the final call. In spite of what radiologist says, in spite of what ultrasound says, pathology is the final diagnosis. Okay. Now, undergraduates, shut your ears. For postgraduates, what if frozen section he tells negative, so you have closed and you have come out? What if the histopathology report comes back as positive? The problem is a frozen section was seen by a postgraduate. Postgraduate will say it is negative. Next, the staff will come see. Staff will say no, it is positive. By then, you have already done the surgery and you have come out. Now, look at the HPR report. Look for the size of the tumor, size of the nodule. If the nodule is less than 1 centimeter size, it is unifocal, and it has all those low risk features what we talked about, okay, then you can put him under surveillance. If not, do a completion total thyroidectomy within 7 days or after 3 weeks, because between this 7 days to 3 weeks there'll be a lot of fibrosis, and when you try to operate in this fibrosis, there's a chance that you can actually damage the recurrent laryngeal nerve and parathyroid during this period. That is why you don't operate during this. Wait for the fibrosis and the adhesions to settle down, then go back after 3 weeks and operate. Okay, that is what we call as a completion thyroidectomy. Now again, chat box, what is the difference between total thyroidectomy, completion thyroidectomy and a redo thyroidectomy? Total, all of us know. Tell me the difference between completion and a redo total thyroidectomy. If you guys know, say yes, or if you tell no, I'll only give you the answer. I know it's a bit too much to ask from UGs. I'm expecting a few PGs to answer. At least tell me no so that I can tell the answer. No, fine. All right, see. Time of performing it, no. Okay, see. I've already given the answer. Completion total thyroidectomy means you have done a hemithyroidectomy for some reason. Okay, for whatever purpose, either it is a goiter or whatever you have done, but it turns out to be cancer, and you go in immediately and you complete the total thyroidectomy. Okay, you are completing it. You have done half surgery and you are completing it. That is called completion total thyroidectomy. Coming to redo thyroidectomy, assume I am a PG. I don't know what I am doing, and instead of doing a total thyroidectomy, I would have done a subtotal. My intention is to do a total, but because of fear, when I'm tying the upper pole or something, I leave off the thyroid gland there only, a bits and pieces of it. Okay. Or I've left a good chunk of thyroid near the upper pole or the lower pole because of fear that I might damage the recurrent laryngeal nerve. I think I've done a total thyroidectomy. So even in my discharge summary and my OT notes, I'll mention total thyroidectomy, but I would have left back some tissue unknowingly. Now there is a recurrence. Okay. Either there is a multinodular goiter recurrence or there's a cancer recurrence and that nodule becomes very big now. In spite of your surgery, you had a recurrence. Now, if you can't use radioactive iodine for whatever reason, and you have to do a surgery in that cases, it becomes a redo total thyroidectomy. You've already done a total, or you're assuming the person previously has done a total, and you're redoing it. You're redoing it. It is called as a redo total thyroidectomy. Whereas, if you've done a hemithyroidectomy and then you're going in and operating, then it becomes a completion total thyroidectomy. Radioiodine scan, calm down, we'll tell you again. Okay, no, completion is not continuing surgery at the same sitting. Not while waiting for frozen scan, that is still called total thyroidectomy. Only if you have closed and come out and then you go back in and operate and take out the opposite lobe, then it becomes completion after you have closed and come out. Okay, so we'll go ahead. Now, till now we discussed what if the thyroid is enlarged or there is a nodule in the thyroid. What if lymph nodes are enlarged? First and foremost, if lymph nodes are enlarged, all of us know clinically we can't palpate the level 6 lymph node, which is the central compartment. We can only palpate the lateral compartment. So if lateral compartment is enlarged, like I've already told you, it has to go to the central compartment and only then go to the lateral compartment. So if lymph nodes are enlarged and they are positive, you have to do a central lymph node dissection and a modified radical neck dissection for the lateral compartment. Okay, only if they are enlarged, no role of prophylactic surgery. If thyroid is normal, don't assume, oh, 85% can be multicentric, they can have spread, so I am going to do it. Don't do it. Only if they are enlarged, that's why I have highlighted, only if they are enlarged, and they are positive, only then go ahead and do a neck dissection. Now, that is about management of papillary. We'll discuss about follow-up of both of them together, because both of them come under the differentiated cancers. So follicular, like we said, is the next most common, 5 to 10%, again more common in female, and here age group is slightly more than that of papillary. Papillary was 30 to 40, follicular is slightly elder age group. Again, clinical presentation, long standing is multinodular goiter, you can have a rapid increase in size, and here dyspnea, chest pain and all can be because of lung secondaries. Don't tell because of compression. It can be because of compression. Again, don't say infiltration. I repeat, infiltration and causing dyspnea is very, very rare. Only seen in anaplastic carcinoma, nowhere else. And anaplastic carcinoma will have a very short history of growth. Here in the first line, I've mentioned long-standing multinodular goiter. Patient comes with dyspnea. Think about either compression, or if it is not causing compression, think of lung secondaries. Get a chest X-ray or a CT scan of the chest to make sure there are no metastasis. Got it? Lymphatics, highly uncommon. So that means cervical lymphadenopathy is uncommon. Again, here there'll be euthyroid, and spread is through bones. And the bony metastasis, what is the classical feature? They are vascular, warm, and pulsatile. This pulsatile bony metastasis are also seen secondary to bony, are also seen in bony metastasis secondary to renal cell carcinoma. So this is the gross and your microscopic picture. Here, like we've already discussed, FNAC is inconclusive. So you have to go based on ultrasound, chest X-ray, X-ray of your bones, if you're suspecting bone secondaries, CT scan of the head. This is an image of a follicular carcinoma metastasis. You can see huge metastasis, which has gone to the skull bones. Here you can see lytic lesions. So again, this is a metastasis to the bone. Now, chat section. I've told you, treatment, I am not even discussing about hemithyroidectomy. Okay, directly it is total thyroidectomy. Why? There are two reasons I want you guys to answer. Angio, metastasis, multicentricity, metastasis. No. It is very simple. Very simple. Okay, calm down. Okay. Before anyone says recurrence, infiltration, spread to capsule and all, please calm down. Spread to capsule is partially correct, Anushree. Okay. First and foremost, before you go. Wait. Stop typing. Total thyroidectomy. Follicular carcinoma is secondary to what goiter? Solitary nodule or multinodular goiter? Fast. What is the treatment for multinodular goiter? Excellent. That's all the answer is. That is why you don't do hemithyroidectomy, because invariably they are multinodular goiters. So no role of hemithyroidectomy. That is why it is total thyroidectomy. See, this is how I like to teach. I want you guys to understand what you're doing. Don't blindly learn. Okay. So now, special consideration, this is only for postgraduates. Okay, there is a role for hemithyroidectomy even in multinodular goiter. That is, a patient has come with solitary nodule. You have done an ultrasound. Ultrasound shows in the same lobe there is a solitary nodule. Along with that, there are other small nodules in the same lobe, but the opposite lobe is relatively normal. So that time you can actually think of doing a hemithyroidectomy. This is only for postgraduates, not for undergraduates. Please don't get confused. So you are going to do a hemithyroidectomy in that time and probably give them thyroxine suppression so that they don't develop multinodular goiter in the future, in the opposite lobe. That is how there is a role for hemithyroidectomy even in multinodular goiter. Very, very rare, but you have to keep this in mind. So now, in such a case, you have done a hemithyroidectomy and HPR has come back as follicular carcinoma. If the size is more than 4 centimeters, do a total thyroidectomy. Size is less than 4 centimeters, they have said if it is low risk, you do a surveillance. If it is high risk, then you go ahead and do a completion thyroidectomy. That means you go back inside and remove the other lobe as well. Now I want to ask you guys a question. This is a theoretical scenario where I've said you do, if it is low risk, you do a surveillance. Okay, I think I'll just give you guys the answer. Okay. First and foremost, I told you one of the criteria for us to call it high risk is capsular invasion and vascular invasion, correct? And we've already told you for us to 100% tell it is follicular carcinoma, it should have capsular or vascular invasion. So if you are calling it follicular carcinoma, it automatically means that it is high risk. So this low risk surveillance and all is only theoretical. This is my personal opinion and what I have discussed with my consultants, and this is what we follow. But textbooks still mention if low risk, then surveillance. But the textbooks also mention that if there is capsular invasion, it is high risk. Okay. So just because it's given in the textbook, I've put it. But for all practical purpose, for follicular carcinoma, it is only total thyroidectomy. Okay. Again, like in papillary carcinoma, if lymph nodes are involved, only if they're involved or enlarged, do a neck dissection. Now let us come to the post-surgical management of a papillary and follicular carcinoma. Now, we have done a total thyroidectomy. Let's assume we have done a total thyroidectomy. Like after that, we got to wait for 4 to 6 weeks before we do the thyroid scan. Can anyone tell me why we have to do 4 to 6 weeks? Why 4 to 6 weeks we have to wait? Why not earlier? I've done now. I want to know within 1 week only whether I have left back some thyroid tissue. No, for a scan, not for fibrosis. Yeah, Vishnu, I think you're a postgraduate. Excellent. I think we spoke that day as well. Yeah. To increase the TSH. Now, if I put this image in the next photo, just give me 1 second. Yeah. Now we'll go back to that picture. Okay. Now please focus again. I told you this is very important. There is no thyroid now. Okay. Thyroid is, we have taken out. But let us assume their thyroid has metastasis either to lymph node or some small remnant of thyroid is left back in our operating field. Okay. For that, like I've told you, jungle mein ek hi sher hai. Your salivary gland and your bones and all will not take up iodine only if thyroid is there. If thyroid is not there, then they also start taking up iodine. So how do you avoid that? First and foremost, wait for 6 weeks. Don't give them any T3, T4. All this T3, T4 will get depleted. Patient will become hypothyroid. When he becomes hypothyroid, TSH will increase, correct? TSH will automatically increase. That is its job. And it will try to stimulate whatever little tissue is there. It will go on stimulating. So wait for 6 weeks. Let the patient become hypothyroid. Now easily he'll become hypothyroid. That time TSH will increase like crazy. Okay. When I say crazy, it means 30 for you guys. Normal is 0.5 to 5. Here you have to wait till the TSH becomes 30. So once it reaches that value of 30, then we've already told you, if TSH is there, it stimulates all the cells with the sodium iodide supporter to pick up iodine. So you have made it so hungry that the minute you give it iodine, it is going to take up. It will not allow the salivary glands or bone. Even this little amount what is there is so hungry that it takes up iodine in huge quantities. Okay, so now let us go back. I hope you have understood that. So wait for 4 to 6 weeks. Wait till the TSH goes really, really high, that is 30, and then do the scan. Okay, if there is any residual disease, do a radioactive iodine ablation. Give iodine 131 and ablate it. When I say ablate it, when you give iodine 131, when it comes back to iodine 53, it will give out gamma radiation and it will destroy those adjacent cells. So the adjacent cell and that cell will get destroyed. So it will kill off all whatever remnant thyroid tissue and metastatic tissue in the lymph node is there, because even lymph node will take up iodine then. Because even the lymph node has follicles at that point of time, even they have sodium iodide supporter, even they will take up the tissue. Got it? That is how iodine works. Now, okay. So you have done it. You have done the ablation. Now, how do you know your ablation is effective? You're going to repeat a scan. Repeat a scan and now see whether any place is taking up tissue. If nothing is taking up, that means your ablation, what you have done is effective. That means you have killed off whatever little metastatic or remnant thyroid tissue was there. You have killed off everything. That means you have done a good job. Then do surveillance. Surveillance, you're going to check for thyroglobulin levels every 6 to 12 months and ultrasound of the neck every 6 to 12 months. Now, what is the function of thyroglobulin? We've already discussed. Inside the follicle, there is colloid. Inside the colloid, there is thyroglobulin. Got it? So if the thyroglobulin level is negligible, that means if it is less than 2, that means there are no follicles anywhere. If it is more than 2, your antenna should go up. More than 2 means, oh, some follicle is left behind. Or somewhere it was very small earlier, now it has started to increase. So keep them on follow-up. If it starts to increase, then you repeat this procedure what we have written here. Again, repeat a scan. If there is something left, again give radioactive iodine ablation. Again, repeat one more thing to see whether your ablation is effective and then go back to doing surveillance. Before I go into stunning, I want to know whether you guys have understood this concept. Yes, if I get at least 5 yeses, I think I've done my job. Yes. Oh, excellent. Fine. I hope this part is very clear for you guys. All right. So now I know most of you will ask, what is thyroid stunning? That is the reason I'd put up the half-life there. Okay. After doing this scan, after 2 days, we do the radioactive iodine ablation. And I've already told you half-life of I-23 is 12 hours. Whereas iodine-131, the half-life is 8 days. So assume you do a scan where you give very little amount of radioactive iodine. the thyroid will take up, it will tell you, oh, I'm here, it will tell you where it is. But the dosage to kill it is not sufficient. So for that, you're going to give a higher dosage in the form of radioactive iodine ablation. But now what will happen, because you've already given iodine 131, it will stay in that gland for 8 days. Okay. Now the gland is happy. It has taken up iodine 131, it's aram se sitting now. Even though TSH is high, it says, I've done my job, I've taken up iodine. So when you give the radioactive iodine ablation, it might not take it up. Okay. So you will have inefficient ablation. That is what we call by stunning. If you have given iodine 131 for the diagnostic scan, the iodine 131 will not be taken up as part of the ablation. That is what we call as stunning of the thyroid. So this is again a chart of the same thing. Please go through it. It's exactly what I've told you. Now finally, we'll come into the smaller parts of it. Hürthel cell carcinoma, it is a aggressive form of follicular thyroid carcinoma. It's a subtype. What are the characteristic features? It has Ashkenazi cells, which has abundant oxyphil. That means it has a lot of mitochondria in it. Now, how does it differ? 30% of them might be multifocal or bilateral. We know that follicular is invariably in one area. If it develops, it will be in one lobe of the thyroid. It does not take up radioactive iodine. That is another important feature. And it is more likely to metastasize to the local nodes. We know that follicular thyroid carcinoma is more of hematogenous. Only 5% or less than 5% of the times it goes to the lymph nodes. Whereas in Hürthel cell, about 25% of the times, that is 1 in every 4, it can go to the lymph nodes. Mortality rate is very high, which is about 20% at the end of 10 years. Again, treatment, do a total thyroidectomy, do a modified radical neck dissection, because we have told you 1 in 4 of them can have lymph nodes. If lymph node is there, do a modified radical neck dissection. Give a TSH suppression. Oh, I didn't talk about TSH suppression. So let us go back here. At the end of surgery, we have done everything. You have removed the thyroid gland. Very little remnant tissue is there. Just assume little remnant tissue is there. And we have told you these remnant tissue, we have done a radioactive iodine ablation also. Even after ablation, assume there is little left. Little, irrespective of what we do, little is left. How do you prevent this from growing? We know that for this to grow, the main cause is TSH, correct? So all you have to do is suppress TSH. So give them a high dose of T3, T4. Anyway, you have to give them T3, T4 because they don't have a thyroid gland. So give them a slightly higher dose. When you give them a higher dose, they suppress the pituitary. When you suppress the pituitary, no TSH. So no stimulation for those little things, whatever is left. So they'll not grow. That is the role of thyroxine suppression, which I missed that time. That is also done for post-papillary and post-follicular carcinoma. Now, a few slides on all these ages, AMS, masses, criteria. All these are only theoretical purpose where they're going to ask you, because we just discussed the most common carcinoma management. Nowhere did staging or this ages, AMS and all come into criteria. So this is only theoretical. They don't play a role in your management. Same thing, your TNM staging also, I'm not going to go into it. You have to mug it up. Please don't ask me how to mug it up, because even I don't know. I just mugged it up for my exam just because I had to. But I know deep down that none of this has any role to play in the surgical management of thyroid carcinomas. So these are the side effects of radioactive iodine therapy. Please go through it. This is again only if you answer everything, only at the end they're going to ask you all this. And now, what are the indications for EBRT or chemotherapy? I think we'll come to this in the end. Okay, I think we'll come to this slide in the end. I don't know how it's come here. So now we have finished completely about papillary, follicular and Hürthel cell carcinoma. One slide about anaplastic carcinoma. It is most aggressive, like I've told you. If you diagnose anaplastic carcinoma clinically, that means patient is going to die in 4 to 5 months, irrespective of what you do. Invariably seen in the elderly. It is usually seen in a case of long-standing goiter, which will be normal. Okay, he'll have a goiter which is there since 20, 30 years. He wouldn't have sought treatment. Somehow that will become anaplastic. And then it starts infiltrating, very aggressive. It will infiltrate through your deep cervical fascia. Anteriorly, it can go into the strap muscles. Posteriorly, it can go into your trachea, to the esophagus, and can cause lots of trouble. And this is how it looks. Here you can see this from the back, it is gone, it's come out like a huge fungating mass on the outside. So you're going to have a huge mass ranging from 3 to 20 centimeters. Obstructive symptoms are usually present at diagnosis, because the guy is so careless that he's not come to you before. He'll come to you only when he has some trouble, which is very advanced, either in the form of esophageal obstruction or in the form of tracheal obstruction. That is why they present only in such late stages, because it has been there since 20 years. It has not troubled him. He's not bothered. He's not the guy who sought treatment at that point of time. He'll come to you only at the end. And like I've told you in the starting, if there is obliteration of the airway, that means infiltration of the trachea, patient will die, and that is the most common cause of death. Treatment, surgical treatment is palliation. Okay, any treatment is only palliation here to make sure it doesn't progress, or if it is already progressed or infiltrated the airway, to reduce it and to make sure he lives as long as possible and he's able to breathe comfortably. So like we were told, just if there is a lot of pressure on the isthmus and it's infiltrating, just remove the isthmus. Don't bother removing an entire thyroid gland, and don't even bother, not worth it, because he's not going to live for more than 4 to 5 months. So for the 4 to 5 months, give him a good quality of life by doing just removing the isthmus, or by giving him external beam radiotherapy or chemotherapy in the form of doxorubicin. Now, this is the third most important cancer. Please pay attention. I know it's already 1.5 hours. We'll finish in the next 10, 15 minutes. Please pay attention now. Medullary carcinoma of thyroid, it can either be familial or sporadic. Sporadic is about 60%. It's the most common. Familial, it is the next 30% of cases. It is not associated with radiation exposure. It originates from the parafollicular cells that we already know, and it is known for its lymphatic spreads. Please highlight this very important question they will ask you. Which has more propensity for lymphatic spread? If they say medullary or papillary, both, none of the above. If they say both, then click on both. But if they say which of them has the most propensity, then it is medullary more than papillary. Okay. It spreads through lymphatics at a very early stage. Even before you realize it, it would have spread through the lymphatics. This is again the cross and microscopic pictures. Now, what do these parafollicular cells secrete? They secrete calcitonin, they secrete CEA, they secrete serotonin. Serotonin can cause diarrhea, so these patients can present with diarrhea. They can present with they can secrete ectopic ACTH, so they can have black patches over the skin. Apart from that, they can also secrete the calcitonin gene-related peptide, histaminidases, prostaglandins E2, F2. Sorry, I think serotonin causes flushing. Calcitonin causes diarrhea, or calcitonin gene-related peptide causes diarrhea. Serotonin causes flushing. Okay, my bad. So clinically, invariably, they present with palpable cervical lymph node. Please keep this in mind. When I'm saying palpable cervical lymph node, it means the lateral nodes, that is level 2, 3, 4. So I've already told you, if level 2, 3, 4 are there, invariably the central compartment is already involved. Okay. So they can present with pain or aching because of all those other symptoms I told you, which is a part of your paraneoplastic syndrome. They can have dysphagia, dysphonia, dyspnea, bone. They can have blood metastasis to the bone, liver, and the lung. Sporadic usually presents in the elderly, and familial, obviously, you know, because it is genetic, it will present at a very early age. And patients with extensive metastasis, they develop diarrhea, and 2 to 4% of the time they present with Cushing syndrome because it secretes ectopic ACTH. So this is men. These are the men syndrome. Please go through it. I'll not dwell too much into it. I want you to concentrate here. MEN 2A and MEN 2B. Medullary thyroid carcinoma can be present bilaterally. Along with that, they can have pheochromocytoma. So in MEN syndrome 2A, 2B, you can have bilateral disease and pheochromocytoma. Please keep this in mind because it matters in our management. So what is the difference between familial and sporadic? Like we told you, sporadic is more common. Sporadic will present as an asymptomatic mass. Familial, because it is genetic, it is more aggressive. So they can present with mass with lymph nodes, and they're usually associated with the RET proto-oncogene, and they can be bilateral most of the times because they're genetic. When genetic means it affects all cells of the thyroid. It is not only one place which has undergone mutation. And in sporadic, bilateral tumors are rare. So how do you diagnose this? First and foremost, we have already discussed parafollicular cells do not have sodium iodide symporter. So your thyroid scan or your iodide scan will not work. It is not effective. So you can neither do scan nor can you do radioactive iodine ablation in a medullary thyroid carcinoma. Same time, one more MCQ question. What carcinoma can you not have in the thyroglossal duct? We discussed this in the anatomy. The thyroglossal duct only contains follicular cells. The parafollicular cells arise from the ultimobranchial body, which then fuses with the medial analogue. So the thyroglossal duct will never have parafollicular cells. So in thyroglossal duct, you can never have medullary thyroid carcinoma. Okay, these are the two MCQ questions they're going to ask you. So how do you confirm your diagnosis? You're going to do an ultrasound, FNAC. In the blood, you're going to get CEA, calcitonin, calcium levels, because we know calcitonin can affect the levels of calcium in the blood. Why do you do pheochromocytoma screening? Because you know in Menn syndrome, pheochromocytoma can be present. And check for RET proto-oncogene. If it is positive, it is more aggressive. You have to do a surgery. Either way, you have to do a surgery. It just means that it is more aggressive because it is a familial type. Now, can anyone tell me why we have to do pheochromocytoma screening? Apart from diagnosing Menn syndrome, why is it important? BMA category. No, I understood. I'm asking why am I bothered about pheochromocytoma? Metastasis, surgery, on table hypertension, thyroxystom. Okay, I think that was thyroid storm, Avantika. That is what you were trying to say. Excellent answer. That is what I was looking for. Now let us revisit what is the function of thyroid hormones. Apart from them acting on the sympathetic system, they also help accentuate or improve the action of the alpha and beta adrenergic, the adrenaline and noradrenaline. That's what I'm trying to say. So thyroid hormones also help improve the action of adrenaline and noradrenaline. So if a patient has pheochromocytoma, he already has so much adrenaline, noradrenaline. On top of that, if you try to do the thyroid surgery, you will cause thyroid storm and the patient will die on table because of uncontrollable thyroid storm. That is not even regular thyroid storm. It will be uncontrollable. In regular thyroid storm, adrenaline, noradrenaline will be normal. Here, first of all, there is so high. So on top of that, if you try to do surgery, you are putting the patient into huge risk. So first, treat the pheochromocytoma. First, normalize that. Then try to do a surgery on the thyroid. I hope you guys got it. That is why you're supposed to do adrenaline or the surgery on adrenaline first, or the adrenals. That is, the pheochromocytoma surgery has to be done first. Then the surgery of thyroid has to be done. That is why for diagnosis, you need this pheochromocytoma screening. You first need to identify whether he's a part of Menn syndrome. If he's part of Menn syndrome, then the management differs. In that management, first you'll be treating the adrenals, then you'll be treating the thyroid. Okay. So for staging, you're going to get a CECT of the chest and the abdomen and PET CT. Why PET CT here? Because you can't do radioisotope scan. If it has small metastasis somewhere to the bone, the limbs, the lower limbs or something like that, if you do a CT scan of the neck and chest, you might not find it out. So PET CT is indicated in medullary carcinoma of the thyroid. And the investigations for the treatment will remain the same. So the treatment for sporadic cases, you're going to do a total thyroidectomy with a central compartment neck node dissection. Why is this? Okay, I've told it has extensive lymphatic spread. So they will have micrometastasis in the lymph node. And clinically, you can't palpate the central group of lymph nodes. That's what I told you. Only when you remove the thyroid, can you go in and have a look at this central group of lymph nodes. So, irrespective of whether they have lymph nodes or not, do a central neck node dissection. So, in this image, I'll show it to you. Do a thyroid surgery. Along with the thyroid surgery, do this. It is a central compartment lymph node dissection. That means here the carotid arteries will come. So whatever is here, these pre-tracheal, pre-laryngeal lymph nodes, you're going to remove. Next, on table, send these lymph nodes for frozen section. Label them separately, left side and right side. If by chance the left side, they say it is positive, do a MRND on the left side as well. Okay, so I'll repeat. Do a thyroidectomy with central compartment lymph node dissection compulsorily in all the patients. And in this central compartment lymph nodes, because you're doing prophylactically, you don't know whether they are positive or negative. whichever side comes back as positive, that means it is already positive and spread to the opposite side. So do a modified radical neck dissection on that side as well. So that is what I have written here. Total thyroidectomy with a central compartment lymph node dissection with an ipsilateral modified radical neck dissection if whichever side the lymph nodes come back as positive. If no lymph nodes are positive, then your surgery stops here. That is total thyroidectomy with central compartment lymph node. Next, there are indications for modified radical neck dissection. If the lymph node is too big, if it's infiltrating the carotid and stuff like that, there are certain criteria for calling it unresectable. Only if it is unresectable, you give external beam radiotherapy. Don't try to do a neck dissection. Give them radiotherapy. That means they're already advanced and it's so much gone ahead that it's no longer in your control. So just give them external beam radiotherapy and hope for the best. Now for postgraduates, okay, for some other reason you have done a total thyroidectomy. Okay, you are assuming it is a follicular. You are assumed that it is a multinodular goiter. You have done a surgery and you have sent it for histopathology. Histopathology comes back as medullary. What are you supposed to do? Go back in, operate on the patient again, and do a neck node dissection. Do a central compartment with a modified radical neck node dissection. By chance, if it is unresectable, give radiotherapy and chemotherapy at that point of time. Now, we discussed about surveillance in papillary carcinoma thyroid. You're going to do thyroglobulin and neck ultrasound. Here, same way, instead of thyroglobulin, we know that parafollicular cells, if they're left back, they secrete calcitonin. So check for calcitonin and CEA every 6 to 12 months. If it is increasing, that means he has a recurrence. So if it is operable, operate. If it is inoperable, give radiotherapy. Simple. Got it? If it is operable, go in and do a surgery and excise either the lymph node or the remnant of thyroid. If it is inoperable, give him radiotherapy and hope for the best. Okay? Last slide, last but one. Indications for prophylactic thyroidectomy. That means there is no cancer, but you are assuming that this patient will develop cancer and you're going to remove the thyroid beforehand. Just like prophylactic mastectomy, this prophylactic thyroidectomy. In patients with MEN2A syndrome, it is compulsory to do a prophylactic thyroidectomy by the age of 5 to 6 years. If it is MEN2B, it is in infancy. For undergraduates, just say MEN syndrome. For postgraduates, you need to specify MEN2A, it is 5 to 6 years. MEN2B, because it is more aggressive, it has to be done, when I say infancy, at the end of 1 year. Before the end of 1 year, you have to do a total thyroidectomy. Thyroid lymphoma, invariably they are non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, high female preponderance, 8:1, more commonly seen in the elderly. Please keep this in mind, it can never be hyperthyroidism. Invariably on FNAC, you're going to have Hashimoto's thyroiditis, which is a form of autoimmune thyroiditis. If the patient has Hashimoto's, that means he has a 7 times risk of developing thyroid lymphoma. So be very careful in these patients. And there is no role of surgery for lymphoma. We've already told you. In lymphoma, the treatment is chemotherapy. Chemotherapy, and if it is too large or it has local spread, you give radiotherapy. So this is just steps of thyroidectomy, which I've already discussed. I've written it. This is for you to answer in your theory question. I'll just run through it fast. You put it in a Cocker's position, Cocker's incision, you cut the skin and platysma. Platysma is cut 1 centimeter below the skin. Can anyone tell me why? Why is platysma cut below the skin incision? Cosmesis is not the correct answer. I went back and read it. Does muscle retract when you cut? Yeah, Vishnu, excellent. Retraction. That's all the answer is. Okay. If you cut skin and platysma will retract beneath the skin and you can't find it. That is the reason you cut platysma 1 centimeter beneath the skin incision. Then you raise subplatysmal flaps superiorly up to the thyroid, inferiorly up to the substernal notch, cut the deep cervical fascia, then you'll find the strap muscles, retract the strap muscles, then you're going to find the middle thyroid vein, ligate it, then go to the superior pole, you're going to find something called the Reeve space, that is between the superior constrictor and the superior thyroid artery. There is a space between these two. That is called as a Reeve space. Create that space, ligate the superior artery. then come to the inferior thyroid artery. Branches are individually ligated. I've told you why. One, because they supply blood to the parathyroid. So if you ligate them in a bunch, you can have hypoparathyroidism, or like we have discussed in the starting, the right recurrent laryngeal nerve or the left recurrent laryngeal nerve, they can run in between the branches of the artery. And if you try to ligate them, you can damage it. Then you mobilize the gland. Then you repeat the procedure on the opposite side. Close the deep fascia. Close the platysma. Closure of platysma is what gives you cosmesis. And then you suture the skin. Alright. So with this, I'll stop sharing and I'll come back to the chat section. Okay. Ojasvi, you asked, goes down or comes up. I think this was in relation to mobility of the thyroid gland. The thyroid moves up with deglutation, but when the gland enlarges, it goes down into the retrosternal. It becomes a retrosternal goiter. Very sign is when you can't palpate the carotid artery. It can be because of two reasons. Either it is infiltrated the carotid sheath, or it is pushed the carotid artery laterally. If it is pushed, that means it is still patent. Instead, palpate for the superficial temporal artery. If superficial temporal artery is palpable, that means the carotid is only pushed. It is not infiltrated. If it is infiltrated, even your superficial temporal artery will not be palpable. Auscultation, can you repeat? Auscultation, you are going to do two things. One, which you guys commonly do, which is auscultation of Bruy, which is at the superior pole of the thyroid. Second is, you are supposed to look for auscultation of the trachea, whether the trachea is deviated. So when you put a stethoscope, you'll hear that breath sounds here. That is called tracheal brash, whether it is on the right side of the midline or left side of the midline or in the midline. This you do when you can't palpate it. Like you're going to use your trail sign, no? Two fingers on the sternal notch and your middle finger you're going to palpate. When you can't do this, you do that. The PET CT scan only in medullary carcinoma, I already told you. In differentiated thyroid cancers, we have an excellent scan in the form of radioisotope, so we don't need a PET CT. It is much more sensitive than PET CT. Whereas in medullary carcinoma, we don't have anything else. That is why we do that. Prithviraj, sir, you told that iodine will be taken up only when TSH is there. But in case of hyperthyroidism, it will be less. No. TSH will stimulate the gland to do its job. In hyperthyroidism, the gland is already doing its job irrespective of what the TSH is telling. It is acting on its own. It will automatically take up more iodine. It will automatically do everything. TSH will act on the normal gland. In a hyperthyroid, it is an abnormal gland which is autonomous, which is not listening to anybody. That is why it will take up iodine on its own. It will start producing hormones on its own and stuff like that. If it is the in a hyperthyroidism, when you give radioisotope, if the nodule takes up most of it, that means it is a solitary or a toxic nodule. If the nodule doesn't take up, but the rest of the gland takes up, then it is called as mostly a toxic multinodular goiter. It is an internodular region which has taken up the iodine. Please go ahead. And guys, one request from my side, please send me a feedback on mail, okay? Please don't make me beg. One is, I want to know whether we can change something in the pattern, because it is taking 2 hours for us to finish thyroid. I don't know whether you guys will be interested for 2 hours in the first place. Second thing is, tell me what topics you want me to cover next so that we can start preparing accordingly. So whichever we get maximum responses, I'll prepare for that topic probably by the next weekend. Neha, my mail ID is, I'll type it here, lkantha.57@gmail.com. It's also on my on the PPT. L Kanta, it's not I Kanta, it's L Kanta. All right. So guys, please, please send me a feedback. I'm telling you, don't make me beg. So kindly send me a feedback and we'll see what we can do with the next class. All right.